Welcome to day number 47, and we are in the book of 2 Peter, and we are now in chapter 3. And again, as always we say, please make sure that you've read the text before we discuss it. But the heading on chapter 3 speaks of the day of the Lord, which is a theme in Scripture. It's not like Peter just comes up with this concept of the day of the Lord. It's an Old Testament thought. It's a thread throughout the Scriptures. And so here we are, and Peter brings this up as a way to encourage people, even challenge people, even charge people to continue to walk with Christ. When everyone else becomes a scoffer or walks away from the faith, you stay in there because the day of the Lord is coming, right? So when we think about the day of the Lord, Peter, sort of think back through the Older into the Newer Testament, what are some of the thoughts that the Bible brings to us about the day of the Lord?
Well, this is kind of a creation and decreation theology happening here.
Okay.
But the day of the Lord, Hayom Yavah, really is a concept born in connection with the Exodus story.
Okay.
It's a sense that on the day that the Lord leads the children of Abraham mm-hmm. out of Egypt
yep.
through the Red Sea
yep.
and crushes the army of Pharaoh in the waters.
And his charioteers, yep.
Yeah, that on this day, the Lord has kind of won. It's this big victory for God.
Right.
Not only against Pharaoh, but against the gods of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
And so Israelite theology carries alive this hope that there would be other days when the Lord would conquer God's enemies.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole hope there is that because God has this incredible favoritism for Israel,
mm-hmm.
that when the Lord crushes his enemies, Israel is
elevated.
Yeah. Israel gets a perk bonus. I don't know.
Right.
But that theology starts to develop in the minor prophets, not because they're less important, just because they're shorter.
Right.
Where the minor prophets will say things like, you think you're going to get away in the day of the Lord? You mm-hmm. got another think coming.
Mm-hmm.
The whole point being that the day of the Lord now becomes not God's strict favoritism for God's people, but when God's going to set the world right. And if God's people mm-hmm. are sideways with that,
correct,
they're going to be, however painfully, brought back into alignment with it.
Correct.
And so when Christians pick up on this, the day of the Lord, I think, and I could be a little wrong about this, honestly, but I think that it becomes these two things, which is, on the one hand, mm-hmm. a lot of that day of the Lord theology gets cashed out in the cross.
Mm-hmm.
This moment where God defeats God's enemies in the cross of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also pushed forward mm-hmm. to when what happens in the cross is going to happen to the whole universe, which is when God defeats God's enemies and brings life out of death.
Right.
And so Peter is encouraging these people to remember, and we talked mm-hmm. about this yesterday, that some of the false teachings that go around in the church that Paul brings up are that this has already happened, the day of the Lord's already happened.
Right.
But Peter is saying, no, you've got to look forward to this day of the Lord, and it will bring you kind of strength and hope and joy. So, you
sure.
know, there's the psalm that sort of most inspiring theologian, Jürgen Moltmann, when we were at his house in Germany,
mm-hmm.
I said, well, some people read you as a universalist.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about that? And he said, well, you know, look at the Psalms where the trees clap their hands and the mountains shout for joy mm-hmm. at the coming of God's judgment. And at the end of Corinthians, every bird has its reflection in the glory of God.
Mm-hmm.
All of creation loves
it's not well. Just the humankind.
So yes. there's this sense that God's judgment, or the day of the Lord, is universal
mm-hmm.
in the sense that when God sets things right,
mm-hmm.
things that are right are sort of brought to
sure.
to flourish and
yeah.
to joy.
Yeah.
And so it's
yeah.
this huge
yeah.
celebratory. It's the weak and the poor and the downtrodden, and those are the people who are
yes.
excited for the day of the Lord.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the long theology
right.
that Peter's working with.
I think it's worth noting, too, that when it comes to the day of the Lord, it did have a focus on Israel's enemies, but there was also the sense of the accountability of the people of God to live right.
Right, that's what develops later.
Yeah. That's right. And so we really see that, though, in Peter, where Peter's basically saying, make sure you don't switch teams and you end up on the team that's going to get God's judgment. Remember to stay in the faith that you have. Now, here's one thing that I noticed, which we pick up in verse 12, and he says this, you accurately said, look, he's telling them, live holy, godly lives, look into the future, this is going to happen. In verse 12, it says, as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming, the day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with this promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. What's interesting is that John the Revelator picks up on this. Yeah. If you look in Revelation chapter 21, you can actually read about what it will actually look like in conjunction with what Peter's saying. So what that leads me to believe is not only did Peter believe this was true about the future, that heaven and earth will be taken away. There'll be a new heaven and a new earth, which actually become one, which is the beauty of it all, is heaven and earth are no longer separated. But this wasn't just something that Peter was preaching. John the Revelator believed in this. And then also what's interesting to me is he mentions the Apostle Paul in verse 15. And it says, bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation, just as our brother Paul also wrote you with the wisdom that God gave him. So he's including Paul in this too. So this theme of the coming judgment of God, where he makes everything right, is something that is clearly understood by the Newer Testament church leaders.
Yeah. Well, Peter also has this helpful note that I think about a lot where he says,
okay.
Our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given in this, given yes. him, as he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters. There are some things in them that are hard to understand, which is so true, which the ignorant and unstable twist their own destruction as they do the other scriptures. Huh. And so here's this kind of interesting moment on the one hand where Peter's like, well, he knows what he's talking about. He does know what he's talking about. But it can be really hard to figure out what Paul is trying to say.
Right,
and
right,
that's,
right.
Nice that he admits that.
Sure.
Now, I don't want to make too much of this because I'm scared that you could. But right. also that last clause, as they do the other scriptures, gives us the sense that these New Testament authors know that they are adding to the body of written works that guide and aid God's people
right.
as they live their lives.
Yeah.
There's a big theological question as to whether the relationship between Jews and the Old Testament is the mm-hmm. same as the relationship between Christians and the New Testament or Christians and the whole Bible, or right. if there's a more, right, because you have kind of two Testaments and two different people and the way
sure.
and you relate all that can be a little complex.
Right.
But at the very least, there's the sense that the scriptures, the written, and that's all it means in Greek, the written things, that Paul's letters are kind of part of that group now, and assumedly Peter's also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I would like to bring attention to what he says right up front. This is now the second letter that I am writing to you,
oh, right.
beloved.
Okay, yeah. So he admits the first one.
Yeah.
Right.
And there's an interesting sense in which we don't know to whom he's writing, really.
Hmm.
He doesn't name a place. He doesn't name a church.
Hmm.
It's just to those who obtained a faith of equal standing with ours.
So Peter and his leadership was over what part of the church? How do we view him?
Well, he's traditionally understood to have been the first bishop of Rome.
Right.
And there really may be a lot of historical credence to that, but that's not what's recorded in Scripture.
That's
we
right.
We don't get the end of Peter's life. I mean, Acts gets really concerned with Paul and kind of
yeah.
leaves Peter behind.
But Peter starts
the
that out, and then it's like the baton almost right. gets handed off. Yeah.
So Peter spends, I mean, he travels a lot. He spends
right.
the most of his career that we know in Jerusalem.
Right.
But there's the sense that he's over all of it. Well, last month, Pope Francis I mm-hmm. published a papal encyclical.
Hmm.
And I think it's meant to be a modern-day version kind of this. Where this, because the Pope is supposed to be the successor of Peter
yeah.
in Catholic theology, the successor of Peter stands up and writes a letter addressed to no Christians in particular, just
oh, I
Christians,
see. Yeah.
and says, I have some thoughts.
Yes.
And so the last papal encyclical was about friendship, fraternity, togetherness.
Oh, wow.
So he wrote about fraternity tutti is what it's called.
Yeah.
And the one before that was on the environment, Laudato Si. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if this kind of Catholic practice of the Pope standing up and saying, well, I'm not really necessarily doing dogma.
Right.
And this isn't one of those texts that's supposed to be infallible and this and that. Mm-hmm. But I have some thoughts about what we need to hear about.
Hmm.
So I want to start a conversation about the environment
or about
fraternity or John Paul II's encyclicals were a lot about rationality and truth. And that seems to be kind of what Peter's doing. He's standing up in the church, kind of announcing all of this stuff. And I also love how he closes it, where he says, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ,
to
be glory now and to the day of eternity. Amen. I like it because in our Protestant tradition, usually grace is something you like get once to get in.
Oh, I see. It's the door. Yeah.
But what if there's a way of looking at discipleship, and Paul will say things like this too, grace to you and peace. What if there's a way of looking at discipleship that also entails growing in grace, growing in God's...
unmerited favor.
Yeah, the word is likability, sort
of. Yeah.
Maybe... that would be a helpful thing for somebody to stand up and go, to all Christians, no one in particular.
Yeah.
We should think about the fact that God still likes us.
Yes.
And holds out grace for us, that we can grow in that.
Yeah. What I like, too, is in that last paragraph is that Peter says, hey, look, but make sure you don't get carried away by this lawless doctrine, this. And so I think in both hands, there's the grace. We need to grow in grace. But we also need to understand and stay with the theology and the doctrines that we know to be true.
Yeah.
Because they preserve you from driving off a cliff.
One of the lawless doctrines may be there's no grace.
Yeah, that may be. Yeah, that it's going back to the law or whatever. Well, that's it for our time together. And so we are going to pray out. Let's pray together. Well, Jesus, thank you for who you are to us. Lord, I do pray that by your Spirit, you would convict us if we begin to adhere to or move towards beliefs that are outside of who Jesus is and what Christ calls us to be. Lord, help all of us who are watching this video to be deeply convicted in this area, but also to understand the depth of the grace and the love of Christ for us. Lord Jesus, thank you that you bring both. And the scripture teaches us that you came full of grace and truth, those two realities spiritually that seem to compete and yet find oneness in you. Lord Jesus, thank you for the text that we've read this day in Christ's name. Amen and amen. Well, God bless you, and we look forward to seeing you at tomorrow's video.